The number of people every day that use internet has been steadily rising in the past decades and is only going to get bigger. We do a lot of our daily tasks on the internet these days, be it browsing the web, buying things online, keeping in touch with our friends, or even accessing important services like banking. At the center of these services lies HTTP. And whether you're a software engineer or just someone interested in technology, HTTP is a foundational concept to know, and we are going to do just that in this series. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. A protocol is just a set of rules that we all agree upon. We use these rules to transfer some data, and the data is called hypertext. Hypertext is any text on a screen which can have hyperlinks. This term was coined in 1965 and is a bit outdated these days. Today, we use the word hypermedia. This includes text, audio files, archives, video files, etc. But we still keep the term hypertext for historical reasons. HTTP is essentially a two-party protocol. The first party is a server. Every website on the planet is hosted on a server or a group of servers. A server is a place that contains data or is a place for users to create data. A client is a program used to read or manipulate data on the server. The client can be a web browser, an app on a phone, or maybe a computer program from the command line. Clients send requests to the server, and the server responds to the client with a response for every request. HTTP has two important properties: it's generic and it's stateless. Generic means that the HTTP specification does not define what can be built using the specification. We can build web servers to interact with different data. We can also build special services such as DNS servers or proxies. HTTP is also stateless in that every request will create a response unless there's something wrong with the connection, but each request response pair is independent and does not make any assumption of past or future requests, and hence it does not store any state. Going back to this server, every server is accessible via an address. And let's consider a case where users' data is accessible at the /users path. This string is called a URL, or a universal resource locator. You use the resource locator to locate a resource on a server. For example, if you wanted to interact with the data of the user Alice, you would do users/Alice, and a different user, user Bob, you would use the users/Bob path, and so on. There are certain actions that you can perform on these paths with the data. You can create some data on this path. You can get data from this path. You can update the data that's available on this path. And finally, you can delete the data that's on this path. These actions in HTTP language are called methods, and there is a method corresponding to each action. For example, to create, you would use post. To get, you would use get. To update, you might use put as the action. And to delete, you might use delete as the method. So these are the definitions of HTTP methods, which correspond to certain actions. There are special cases, however, and exceptions to these rules, and we will get to that later. The request message specifies the action along with the data for the action. The server returns a response to the client for that action. The content of the response depends on the action. The server must indicate if the action was successful or if the action failed, why it failed. This indication of success or failure is part of the response message itself. All HTTP response methods contain a field called the status code. Status codes are three-digit numbers, and here are some examples. The first digit indicates the type of the message. And based on the types, we have five different categories: informational, success, redirection, client error, and server error. there are lots of terms and definitions to HTTP, which we will cover in this series. Let's first look at some examples so that we cement the basic idea of HTTP. There are two parties in HTTP, the client and the server. The server makes URLs available to the client to access certain data. The client sends a request to the server, and the server responds to that request by sending a response. In the first example, the server makes a GET request. If you remember, GET is one of the possible actions, and the GET action is used to retrieve some data from the server. In the initial case, the server does not contain any information, so it returns a negative response with the status code 404, indicating that the requested data was not found. In the next example, the client creates this data on the server. It uses the action of type post, and along with the post request, it also sends the data that needs to be created. The server accepts this request and sends a response of 201, indicating that the data was created. Now that the data is created, the client can request this data at any time, and this is done using the GET request. Now, the server returns a positive response and also the data that was requested by the client. Now, for some reason, if the client wants to update this data, the client sends a PUT request. The request on the server gets modified, and the server returns a 200 positive response to say that the data has been modified. And finally, to complete the flow, the client might want to delete this data, and it can use the request of type delete. This action will delete the entity on the server, and once the entity gets deleted, the server returns a 200 positive response, which tells the client that the requested action has completed and the data has been deleted. So this is a basic concept called CRUD, create, read, update, delete, and this is how you use the HTTP methods to do these actions.